Hey there, this is a fan-made audio version of a little-known series on Reddit called Wait, Is This Just Gate? It was written by user/PepperAntique, and all credit goes to him, except the music. Yes, that's right, music. Credit for the music goes directly to the composers and companies that own them. Now, without further ado, let's get on with the show. After the interrogation, and sending his message, James was led to the veranda several levels higher up in the castle. It was a simple space, tiled floor that swept out in an arc from the building. It had an awning made of white stone lattice that looked like marble, going up about 20 feet. The lattice was weaved through by a vine that reminded him of his mother's star lavender vine she'd grown when he was a kid. But the flowers were a bright, bright red, and they smelled like cinnamon. But as interesting as the flowered awning was, the view was what really stole his attention. Normally, he would have noticed the sprawling estate of the castle they were in. The acres of garden, the small training area, the stable, the small farm field, complete with greenhouse, and an area that he was fairly certain was a parade ground. He also might have noticed nearly a mile away that there were walls, roughly 100 feet tall, being patrolled by guards and having ballista and catapults spaced here or there. But James was too busy looking up. So there is a sun. Good, I'll be able to charge my phone. Looks like the moon is coming up too. But holy hell, this planet has rings. Looming over a good portion of the sky was a long, arcing smudge of brown and blue that he'd recognized immediately. Only a few years before, NASA had finally revealed the images that a probe had taken of the rings around Neptune, all of which had been taken from within the outer edges of the planet's atmosphere. The images had fascinated him. Space always had. And now, he was looking at some honest-to-God planetary rings from the surface of a planet. And he wasn't even wearing his full uniform, much less an EVA suit or something. Whoa, was all he could manage. You mentioned needing sunlight earlier. I wasn't sure if you had had a chance to take a good look out a window yet, Kayla said from beside him. I figured you might like a chance to see the sky firsthand. Yeah, this is nice. He was clearly distracted. Thanks. How does it compare to your home? Honestly? Kinda blows it out the water. Really? The werewolf asked, a hint of confusion in their voice. Yeah, we don't have rings around our world, he said. That's some real sci-fi type shit. Sci-fi? Some other time, James said. That's a lot to unpack. You'll understand once I do, though. At this, the werewolf simply shrugged and looked back out, though they seemed to focus more on the training grounds, not that James noticed. After another minute or so, the wind picked up and James felt a chill and shuddered from the cold. He'd forgotten that he was only wearing a t-shirt and pants. Come, night is nearly upon us. The wolf began walking toward the door inside. I shall show you to the baths and we shall get you some proper sleepwear. Yeah, James replied. He took one last look out before turning around. Two moons, cool. I suppose I can't be too surprised. Rings. Fucking wild, man. He thought before walking inside. After a few minutes of walking in contemplative silence, Kella and James arrived at the baths. It had a picture of a bathtub with steam coming out of it, and more of those symbols that James couldn't understand. Please, go in and do whatever you need to refresh yourself for the night. I shall go and find some sleeping clothes for you, Kella said while looking about. There are servants in there to aid you as needed. I'll meet you afterwards. Oh, okay. You don't need a bath? We werewolves use different bathing areas. Fur, Kella said after seeing his confused look. Ah, gotcha. Guess that makes sense. The bath was heaven. James had never been a spa and nail day kind of guy. His first non-commanding officer back home, Sergeant Thompson, had sworn by manipeds and spa days, especially after a field exercise. But James had never seen the point. But he was definitely a jacuzzi tub kind of guy. He'd fully intended to get one installed whenever he settled down and started a family in a house of his own. Not that that was an option anymore. The bathtubs in the castle's ambassador wing would make a jacuzzi look like a mud-filled hole in the ground. Each of the tubs was set into the ground and looked to be made of bronze. When he stepped in, the bottom of the tub lit up with a soft orange glow and he felt the floor of the tub shift into a new shape. As he lowered himself into the water, he felt the water quickly rise from the room temperature it had just been, up to a nice balmy warmth that felt absolutely perfect. And as he sat down, he landed in a chair that he didn't remember being there a moment ago. It was the exact size and angle he needed to recline comfortably. He was just about to truly begin relaxing when suddenly a voice from behind made him jump a little bit. Welcome, sir. I see you're enjoying the bathtub. The royal family had them installed specifically to impress guests here at the castle, said a well-dressed young man holding a basket with bottles in it. Yeah, this is nice. Glad to hear, sir, the attendant replied. What kind of cleansing solution would you need today? And do you have a preference in scent? Just soap and shampoo, I guess. Do you guys have citrus scent? Of course, sir. The young man grabbed a small bar of soap and a small orange vial. Guess citrus is pretty universal, James thought. Is there anything else you desire of me, sir? I guess some towels for afterwards, he said. No need, sir. You'll find towels just on the half wall over there. At this, the young man pointed to a low wall with several cubbies full of various towels and robes. Also, we've placed the sleepwear that Captain Kella procured for you. You'll find them there as well. Oh, cool. Thanks, man. Of course, sir. Enjoy the bath. Then the young man quickly walked over to another tub several yards away. In that tub sat a person who was covered in scales, though in all other ways they looked as human as anyone else. Upon seeing this, James realized he should probably look around a bit. The room had about 10 different tubs in it, and one that might as well be called a pool. Each was roughly 4 to 5 yards apart from the next. He saw the fish lizard person. One had two people in it that looked like they could be twins, and also had glowing golden hair. One of the tubs had a person in it who had to be at least 8 feet tall, and looked like they could bench press the striker he'd been in. That guy was also covered from head to toe, or at least to water, with blue tattoos that seemed to writhe ever so slightly when he looked at them. He quickly looked away when the man looked at him. Two of the remaining tubs were filled with run-of-the-mill humans. Yep, D&D land. I'm in D&D land. Awesome. So awesome. He thought sarcastically. After about 20 minutes, during which he only broke down and dissociated a little bit, James finally wrapped things up. The soap and shampoo smelled like apricots and lime. Not quite what he'd expected, but still nice. He walked over past the half wall and dried himself off before putting on the night clothes. They were basically just a pair of green silk pajamas. The pants were a touch short, but they were comfortable enough. They also had a pair of good old-fashioned flip-flops. He was pretty sure his mom had hit him with a pair just like them when he was a kid. Even in Fantasyland, children must know to fear la chancla. The thought made him laugh as he walked out the door. What's so funny? Kella asked. The large wolf had been waiting for him, apparently, the armor and bandages having been replaced by a larger, golden-red version of what he was wearing, minus the flip-flops. The thought entered his head too fast for him to stop. Imagine the sound a pair of flip-flops would make if a damn werewolf was wearing them while running on these stone floors. And James burst out laughing even harder. After a minute of trying to get his bearing back, James looked back up at a fairly clearly annoyed Kella. I'm sorry, just... He stopped to breathe for a minute. Just stupid thoughts. Another breath. Thoughts about how similar some things are, even when they aren't. The wolf stared at him. It was obvious that Kella wasn't amused. So where do I sleep? Dungeon? Tower guarded by a dragon? Royal chambers? He said the last option in a posh English accent. Actually, since I'm now a member of your pack, you'll be staying in my quarters. Wait, what? James asked. We're sharing a room? James asked. Yes. Typically, they would put you up in an ambassador suite, but since you've blooded me and gained my allegiance, I am honor-bound to offer up my dwellings, Keller replied, matter-of-factly. Okay, so... I don't know the way werewolves do things, James said, concern evident in his voice. We're not going to be all bundled up like a pair of dogs, are we? Caleb bristled a little bit at the comparison. No offense meant, I just don't know what any of this means. James legitimately didn't. If, Caleb responded, clearly annoyed, that is your desire, then we can. As my pack leader, you are entitled to such a request. No, what I would prefer, Caleb interrupted, if you at least allowed me to discuss it with my mate. James was interrupted again, because Kella was opening the door to said dwellings while continuing. But I believe that you should look at the lodgings before you jump to conclusions. Okay. James decided to listen and hold his tongue for a bit. The entry room was effectively also an armor storage room. Standing on 5 separate racks were different sets of armor in different sizes and configurations. One rack was empty. He guessed it was for the armor that he had shot. The other 4 had smaller sets of armor, the smallest of which looked like it could fit him, albeit snugly. Whose armors are those? Mine, Keller replied. What? Oh, right. I suppose we haven't gone over the specifics of how werewolves actually work. At least in this world, Keller said. I asked about your world's depictions of werewolves, but that's not how they work here. How do they work here? I mean, you haven't changed since I've seen you. And indeed, you won't notice it, Kella stated. The change is slow, gradual. It occurs in line with the howling moons, Kella paused. That's the larger moon. When James nodded, understanding the wolf continued, it occurs in line with the howling moon's phases. The full moon, and as such my greatest form, occurred 4 days ago. Over the course of the next 45 days, I will gradually become more human. Hence the extra sets of armor, all of which are interchangeable as my form acquires. James hadn't even noticed that the two of them had continued into the main room. Huh, that's kinda cool, I guess. Makes sense, too. I mean, the moon never actually goes anywhere. He looked at Kella. It doesn't go anywhere, does it? No, it simply gets blocked by the other moon, and sometimes our planet's rings. Okay, good. He didn't know why the concept of a roving moon worried him, but it did. This information was a relief. Then he realized where they'd walked and looked around. Whoa, dude, this room is sweet. The werewolf cocked its head to the side. Heh, it's like a dog, James thought. Thanks, but it is simply a captain's room. Not terribly fancy. Or sweet? Sweet is just a term for something unexpectedly nice, James said. I kinda had something similar to my old barracks room in mind. Or, you know, an officer's barracks room. Well, as a captain, I am occasionally expected to entertain, or keep an eye on, foreign dignitaries, Kella stated. The warning was pretty obvious. As the wolf said this, they opened a set of doors that revealed an even larger and nicer bedroom. As such, this is actually the room you'll be staying in. The subtext that was what Kella would prefer was also obvious. It's furnished more lavishly, for those potential dignitaries. Besides, it requires you to pass through my room in order to leave. Ah, gotcha. James was actually impressed. That was just plain practical all around, and the room was very nice. James was surprised to see his assault bag sitting on a chair, along with all of his uniform. It had been washed and pressed, and even the boots had been cleaned. And he could have sworn resold, though he doubted this place had rubber to do so. But as he rifled through his bag, he noticed that all the electronics and actual gear was gone. It was just a spare set of clothes, his toiletry bag, and some little convenient items he'd packed for NTC. Guess they're not dumb enough to let me get my phone back yet. Or anything else useful for that matter, he thought. Totally fair. Suddenly, a loud howling noise sounded from behind him, along with a light cold breeze. He jumped a little bit. When he did, he saw that a door was open and the moonlight was spilling in through it. The howl lasted nearly a minute, and, to him, at least, it sounded incredibly sad. Outside the door was a small porch, on which was a small cushioned seat that reminded him of his grandmother's ottoman. Kella sat on the seat, crouching down like a baseball catcher, but with hands braced in the porch's railing. He was about to ask what the werewolf was doing when he heard another howl off in the distance. This one sounded sad too. James decided to simply sit back and watch. The exchange lasted for 8 more howls each. Each one seemed to have a different tone, and he didn't get the same sad feeling from any of them after the first. As they continued, he looked at a small painting of a couple standing in front of a castle that looked like it had been ripped from a Disney movie. He wasn't sure if it was just the painting, but it looked like it was made of glass, too. What was that? James asked once Kella had walked back inside. Howls are how werewolves converse over long distances. That howl you heard replying was my mate, Kella replied. That first howl you let out kinda surprised me, but it also sounded really sad. It was. I normally work for 4 days, have a half day off in the middle, and then 4 more. Then I have a 3-day break before my next shift, Kella stated. The injuries you gave me, coupled with your new status as my pack leader, and my new responsibilities regarding you, prevented my last break. Kella interrupted. Hand raised. There is no need. It is not your fault. Our howls cannot recreate full sentences, but as you may have noticed, they carry much emotion. My mate understands what happened. Besides, the princess carried word while you and I were still recovering. Oh, okay, I guess. Still sorry, James said. The wolf nodded. Thank you. I will see them again soon. James pointed at the painting, saying, You said that you basically become human when the moon fades, so is this you and your mate? Yes, it is. That painting was made about 2 years ago now. She's pretty cute, dude. And cool castle. What's it made of? James asked. Thanks, Kella replied, a look of confusion evident. It's made of magically grown diamond. It's considered one of the wonders of this world. Dude, that's badass. James, quick question, Kella queried. Yeah? You said she's cute. You know that's me, right? What? Kella continued. James, I'm a woman. I suppose you're not accustomed to werewolf forms, but I am a woman. What? James did not sleep well that night. He didn't sleep well, partly because he was a stranger in a strange land sleeping in a strange bed. A larger part was the fact that he'd been through a lot since he'd woken up that morning, and he was still trying to process the fact that his friend and NCO was dead and had died in his arms. Oh yeah, there was also the fact that just one doorway away was a supposedly badass warrior werewolf loudly snoring away. On top of that, he had mistakenly assumed said werewolf was a guy for most of the day. James wasn't typically a socially awkward guy. He was also fairly accepting of people's genders, identities, and sexuality. He himself was straight, and only thought of himself as just a dude. But he knew plenty of people who swung the other way, or both ways, or no way at all. He knew people who didn't agree with their born gender, and even a few who had had that surgically corrected. He didn't completely understand the idea himself, but he had never had a problem with it. And while he had occasionally mistaken a person's gender identifiers before, he'd always been quick to apologize and correct himself. But he'd assumed Kella was a male the whole day. He'd assumed that Kella and the princess had been flirting when they were arguing about their martial prowess. Good God, he'd even asked about sleeping with her. Granted, he'd been explicitly trying to ensure that that wasn't expected of him, but the she-wolf had clearly been aggravated at the mere notion of it. Oh God, my dick was flopping around in her face when she had to restrain me. The thought made him feel like dying a little. Embarrassment abounded. It had been one of the few times in his life where he had been so socially uncomfortable that he hadn't known how to process it. He'd simply apologized as much as he could and shut up as much and as quickly as possible. Kella, to her credit, had actually been very understanding. After realizing that the subject had never really come up, and also remembering that James really truly didn't actually know anything about her world, much less werewolves, she had explained that when werewolves were in full form, as she was currently, their genders were effectively indistinguishable to most people, or at least to most people who hadn't spent their lives around werewolves. People like James, who had never even seen a werewolf outside of a movie or a Halloween party, and who, up until today, had kind of thought werewolves were lame. After roughly 20 minutes of Kella explaining things, while James mostly just apologized or remained silent, the two had simply agreed to go to bed. James had a meeting with the king the next day and would need his rest. The last thing James thought before finally managing to fall asleep was, "I know it's not really my fault, but I'm a fucking dumbass. A very tired fucking dumbass." Also, holy hell, it sounds like she's running a chainsaw in there. Then he drifted off. When James awoke the next morning, privately wishing that when he'd opened his eyes it would turn out he'd just had a really vivid dream, he did so to the familiar and lovely smell of bacon. After brushing his teeth and shaving in the small bathroom, he was pleasantly surprised to find that it had running water, James dressed in his full uniform and knocked on the door between the rooms. "Hey, Kella, can I come in?" "Of course, breakfast is here," she replied. When he opened the door, he saw the most glorious sight since he'd gotten here. On the table that Kella was sitting at was a large platter piled high with fried eggs, diced and fried potatoes, some kind of green cubed something, a small basket of rolls, and a large pile of thick-cut, heavily peppered bacon strips. "Oh man," James exclaimed while taking a deep sniff of the breakfast. "Okay, I don't know enough about this place to know what level of society y'all are at, but if you got bacon, then as far as I'm concerned, y'all are all right. An odd way to judge a society, but I must admit, I would be most upset if bacon were not available somewhere," Kella agreed, smiling as she shoved an entire strip into her fanged maw and began chewing. "Can I get some?" James asked as he sat down at the opposite seat. "Of course, they only brought this to the room because you are here. Normally I would have to go down to the banquet hall for food, or else the soldier's mess." "Awesome. Say, what's this green stuff? It smells sweet," James asked, holding one of the green cubes on the end of his fork. "Smep, please," Kella said, as if it was obvious. "Smep, please? A fruit that grows in the region on the other side of the Kaban River?" She said this as if simply reciting a fact that anyone should know, while also shoveling eggs into her mouth. "It helps with digestion, recovering from sickness, and helps sailors avoid salt sickness on long journeys." "Right," James said. He shrugged and put the green cube in his mouth. His face immediately scrunched up. This stuff was sour. No, this stuff wasn't sour. It was evil. Kella let out a loud guffaw. "Here," she said while skewering another green cube and dipping it in a small bowl of salt. "Like this." She put the salted fruit on his plate. "God, it's like a grapefruit got amped up from 11 to 1,000, James said while struggling to unscrunch his face. He forked the new piece and held it up. "This isn't gonna melt my tongue off, is it?" "No. Salt is the cure for pork, beef, and smeply face. That's the saying." He reluctantly put the small fruit in his mouth and was immediately dumbstruck by the difference in flavor. Where the previous smeply piece had been so sour he thought his cheeks would break his teeth, this piece was so sweet that it reminded him more of a piece of candy. It also vaguely reminded him of apple cider. "Holy crap," James said. "That's a fucking huge difference, dude. He quickly skewered two more pieces on his fork and dipped them into the salt pile as well. They were in his mouth before he'd even finished chewing the previous piece. Killa watched, amused, as the young soldier across from her experienced something that most people in this land learned as toddlers. James quickly piled his plate full of breakfast and began tucking in. "Shoal, what's the plan for today?" he asked. "First off, practice some manners. The wolf in me would gladly devour this plate from the floor if I'd let it run the show, but I don't even speak with my mouth full." James swallowed. "Sorry, just didn't realize how hungry I was." "But the main thing today," Kella continued, ignoring him, "is to introduce you to the king. When you meet him, he will discuss what the gods have said regarding your summoning. Then the two of you will come to an agreement on your status here in the kingdom." James gulped. "That sounds like a pretty big thing. Also, gods?" "Indeed it is," Kella replied. "And yes, this world has gods. The land and its people are at their mercy, and often live and die at the hands of their machinations." She paused. "Your summoning was partly their doing. The summoners request someone who can save our world, and the gods make that determination and pull someone from the nearest realm in the periphery, for better or worse." James needed to process that for a minute. Kella waited. She knew she'd just put a lot on his shoulders. "So, I'm expected to save this world?" Kella nodded slowly. "That is the expectation, though it is not for any of us to decide how you do so." "What do you mean?" Kella thought for a moment. She had to word this as best as she could to avoid confusion. "Well," she said, "this kingdom, Petrovus, and its royal family, Princess Amina's family, has existed for nearly 2,000 years. She thought for a moment longer. "Parts of the castle, and in this case specifically the summoning room, have existed for nearly 8,000. "Shit, that's a long time." "Indeed. And in those 8,000 or so years, 24 separate summonings have occurred, yours included," she said. "Each one has been during a time of strife, or extreme stagnancy, and each summoning has had wildly different results." "You guys have records of all the summonings? Also, what kind of results?" "We have records of most of the summonings, and as for results, well, they vary," she replied. "How so?" "For starters, it's not always a person that comes through the portal. Even when it is a person, they are not always members of a recognizable race here in our world." She pointed at James. "Take yourself, for instance. You are a human." James looked at himself, suddenly unsure. "You've seen other humans here at the castle. Hell, the princess is human, and she punched you in the face." "Well, yeah," James responded. "And yet your face, your eyes, your nose, the color of your skin," James knew where she was going. "I have traveled all over this land, and I can honestly say that I have never seen a human who looks like you. Not in any of the other nations I've visited either. You, James, are unique, for that alone, even if nothing else about your anatomy is." "So y'all ain't got no Asians here?" James asked. This was actually legitimately a surprise. He'd never even considered that possibility. "James, I don't even know what that is." "Damn. I don't even know why, but I feel incredibly offended for some reason," he said while trying to think of all the other humans he had seen so far. It wasn't exactly a large number, but still, she was right. "That's real fucked up, man," he said quietly, more to himself than anyone else. "I understand your feelings. I was somewhat delighted when you knew what I was," Kella admitted, "but I became somewhat upset when I discovered that you only knew of them as myths and fairy tales. I can't imagine what it must be like to not have your own kind here." "Yeah, I honestly don't know how to feel about that," James admitted. "Regardless," Kella continued, "sometimes it is not a person. One time it was a cluster of rabbits." "Really? Rabbits?" James thought. "You're clearly thinking the same thing the summoners did at the time. But the rabbits were accompanied by an emissary of the gods, who gave instructions to eat several of the rabbits and to release the rest of them into the wilds in different parts of the country." "Shit, rabbits are like a super invasive species." James was honestly flabbergasted at the idea. "Yes, that is very much the case," Kella replied. "But at the time, our land was being destroyed by several species of invasive plants. Most of our animals had starved or had been increasingly hunted by starving people and omnivorous animals. To put it simply, our land was in the middle of a food crisis." Once again, James knew where she was going. "Let me guess," he said. "The rabbits ate the invasive plants, and their rapid birth rate resulted in the people and the animals of the land having a new abundant source of meat that also brought a balance back to the plants and the ecosystem." "Exactly so. And in the course of only a few years, the famine ended, both for the people of the land and the wildlife." After a minute, Kella continued. "That was a more esoteric summoning, a bit of a one-off, as they say," Kella said. "Okay, but you also said that the summonings sometimes aren't good. Several times the summonings have brought forth creatures, and sometimes people who have been..." She thought for a moment. "I don't want to say villainous, because the king's ancestor was one of them, but..." She thought some more. "Let's just say that they seemed villainous at the time." "Okay?" At times, the summoning has brought forth people and creatures so evil or deadly that they effectively forced the nations of the world to work together. She paused. Sometimes entire nations were wiped out or absorbed as a result. Sometimes the world was so destabilized that the old factions were completely reorganized into new ones. Entire societal shifts have occurred because of who or what was summoned, sometimes for better, sometimes for worse. Huh, I guess I kind of understand that. The best way to explain, I think, would be to ask you if there has ever been a person in your world's history that was pivotal to society, good or bad, Killa said. Yeah, there have been people like that. His history books had been filled with them. The Jesuses, the Hitlers, Typhoid Marys, Pol Pots, Stalins, Martin Luthers, and Martin Luther Kings. The dreaded Kardashians whose rise had marked the decline of society in the early 2000s. His world was still recovering from the shallow stupidity that clan had inflicted upon the world. We have plenty of people who've been the center of our world's changes in society. Well, Kella said, imagine if they had never existed. Or imagine if they hadn't existed until you summoned them. That thought experiment has existed in our world forever and a day. Yeah, would you kill baby Hitler has been a social conundrum since before I was born. Well, typically, when a summoning is performed, it is done solely to summon a hero who can save us in our time of need, Kella reiterated. But what we believe we need to survive, and what the gods think we need to survive, Kella shook her head, they're not always the same thing. Well, your gods are starting to sound like an awful lot like the gods my world used to worship, James replied. Who knows, Kella asked. Maybe they are one and the same. God, I sure hope not, James replied, not oblivious to the irony of that statement. Either way, we have literally and figuratively chewed the bacon long enough. It is time to ready you for an audience with the king, Kella said as she stood up. Sweet. How formal am I expected to be? James asked. Kella considered the question. It can be hard to tell. She noticed the confused look on James's face. You'll see. Hey, so this is the outro. It's not scripted like the intro was, but I'm here to talk, not to actually do an outro. Or am I? I don't know. Could be either way. Point is, I'm learning new stuff. I have new software that I'm using. I'm using Audacity instead of OBS, which is probably what I should have done from the start. So in the future, I fully intend to completely remaster the previous audios in the channel. Especially because this one already blows those out of the water, and all I really need now is a better voice and a better mic. Maybe some soundproofing, and I think I'll be good to go. But outside of that, it's a matter of learning some skill, getting better, so practice makes perfect. I hope I can see anyone who watches this video in the, well, next one, whenever that may be, hopefully soon, as long as life decides to be nice to me. See ya.